I want to thank everyone for coming out this evening. This is a very special pleasure for me to be able to sit down with our guests this evening and have you join us as well. My name is Preston James. I am the entrepreneur in resident at the Herb Kelleher Center, which is in the McCombs Business School. The Herb Kelleher Center is the major advocate for all things entrepreneurship at the University of Texas campus. It is responsible for research and programming to actually educate students and faculty and also encourage aspiring entrepreneurs and pursuing careers in entrepreneurship as well as in investment. We work alongside with many of the other schools on campus in a collaborative manner to really pull together programs that we feel are valuable to our students and faculty to really build a stronger community around entrepreneurship, not just on campus, but also off campus with the Austin community and communities beyond. So again, on behalf of the Herb Kelleher Center, Director Lewis Martins is here joining us this evening, as well as the staff outside, Sherry Gonzalez, Emmanuel Ibarra. We thank you for coming this evening, and we thank our wonderful guests that we have here tonight with me, Dr. Bernard Harris with Vesalius Ventures, and also Dr. Sara Brand with True Wealth Ventures. I should be calling myself Dr. Preston James of the UT. Tonight I wanted to provide a quick overview of both of our guests here, who are also dear friends of mine as well, and not to spend too much time because if I read off their career and all of their accomplishments, it'll be 7 o'clock and we'll be walking out of here for dinner. But very quickly, let me start with Sara. Sara is a Longhorn, so give it up for her. All right, there we go. She has a Bachelor's of Mechanical Engineering here at UT, also received a Master's in Mechanical Engineering at Cal Berkeley, and also a PhD at Cal Berkeley. Over her career, very briefly, she began as a researcher at Intel and Semitech, and also as a technologist. And then she also spent time as a consultant at McKinsey Company, and then also became a VC, part of a VC firm called Fremont Ventures. And then from there, went on to a corporate executive career at AMD, and then managed somehow to become an entrepreneur and started a company with her husband called 512 Brewing Company, which is still in operation today. And then most recently, actually started her own VC firm called True Wealth Ventures, which she launched in 2016 and is actually doing amazing things here in Austin. So welcome again to Sara.
Thank you.
And Bernard, a remarkable career as well. Actually, as a graduate of University of Houston, pursued a bachelor's in biotechnology and in biology. I'm sorry, and then also pursued his MD in musculature.
Well, the MD is just simply the MD.
MD. And then went on to an amazing career at NASA, where he had a veteran astronaut of 18 years and logged over 438 hours and 7.2 million miles in space. Wow. And in that journey also became the first African American male to walk in space. But thank you. And then there were several other firsts along that path that I understand, even Bernard wasn't even aware of at that time, but truly a pioneer in telemedicine and actually conducted the first telemedicine conference from space back in that time. And then Bernard, after his time at NASA, went on to become a vice president and chief scientist at SpaceHab, which was a venture-backed technology company, and became a corporate executive there. And then thereafter, decided to become a venture capitalist, starting Vesalius Ventures. So as you can see, we have two amazing guests with remarkable careers, very diverse careers, which we're going to talk a lot about to find out about these amazing journeys. All right, so let me go ahead and get started. So my first question, as I've gotten to know both of you, I've been really just, looking at your careers and, how you've done different things, right? And if I was talking to some other people, I would say, oh, you've bounced around, right? But you guys didn't bounce around. You guys actually had, careers that take you different paths, and you had a tremendous amount of success in each of them. So let me just ask you this quick question. Did you envision, maybe in your younger days, that you would end up being a venture capitalist, when you were going to school to get your mechanical engineering degree and you were going to school to get your biology degree? Was venture capitalist even a thought? And if not, tell us a little bit about, sort of your path of how you got there. Sara, I'll start with you.
No, I didn't even know what a venture capitalist was when I was younger. And never ever really knew exactly what I wanted to do when I grew up, and when I was getting my education at least. Just knew I liked thinking about how things work and understanding how things worked, and so that's really kind of why I went into mechanical engineering and just kept plugging away for a while at it. And then realized I didn't want to do really deep, technical something which may or may not make an impact in the world, and where I really, what was really a priority to me was making a difference in the world and applying the technology to things that would, make a positive impact. And so I switched gears and realized I needed to understand how businesses made decisions and how executives made decisions. And that's when I switched gears and went to McKinsey & Company. And then venture capital became this perfect mecca for me of the combination of using my technical background to meet with entrepreneurs and think about the next great ideas, but also really use my business background and help those portfolio companies with whatever they needed.
Fantastic. Bernard, what about you? I mean, I know you were inspired to be an astronaut, at the young age of 13. And I remember watching that same 1969, right, space mission at that time. And then from there, you wanted to be an astronaut, but here you are getting a degree in biology, and then, boom, VC. So,
like Sara, I never even knew what a venture capitalist was, and probably till about 15 years ago. And as you've already said, my background decided when I finished high school that I would, go into biology at U of H, and I have to put a plug in for my medical school, Texas Tech. You missed that. Just we're here at UT, and I've got to put that in there. I eventually found my way at NASA, and as you've said, I was one of those crazy kids that when I arrived in college, I knew what I wanted to do. I sort of mapped out that I found out when I was researching, what it took to be an astronaut, that they had medical doctors that worked in the space program. So I kind of put the two together, said, I'll go and be a pre-med student and then go to medical school and then sort of find my way into working at NASA, which I did as a researcher for a couple of years before I became an astronaut. And it wasn't until I had finished my career as an astronaut that I started thinking about what else do I want to do? I was at that point, I was 39 years old. I completed two missions and had done a number of firsts, as you said. And so I was looking for, what's the next opportunity? And then I went back to my days at U of H when I took this course in economics. And in fact, it was a black economics course that was taught by an African-American entrepreneur who was a millionaire. And it was the first time that I had heard of a black person being a millionaire, outside of maybe sports or music or something like that. And so I went back and I remember as I went through that course, that he put this bug in my head about being an entrepreneur, about, you know, getting into business. So then I stepped out and said, okay, how can I take my skills as a physician and researcher and astronaut and try to turn that into a business opportunity? And I realized that my skill set was around telemedicine. And so when I decided to make the move, I said, well, I want to stay in a field that I know, and I want to get involved in something that's going to allow me to look at technologies and possibly work with other entrepreneurs. And just so happened, a good friend of mine who founded Vanguard Ventures invited me to join his firm. And I became an entrepreneur in residence. And, you know, for the audience here, what that means is that you go and work for a venture capital firm for free. You don't get paid, but you go there for the opportunity to learn. And that was my first exposure to venture capital.
Wow, that's fantastic. That's fantastic. And the reason why I pointed that out is because I know so many students and even, you know, just people in general pursue their careers, and they sort of have a single-minded path about it. And, you know, I think this is kind of, you know, proof in, or actually all three of us are probably proof that, yes, you can have that career, but then things actually open up, you know, opportunities open up based on your interests, based on your passions, and things in your expertise, if you will. So Bernard, I want to go back. Something I think is kind of funny, we talk about you were viewed very much as a pioneer in telemedicine back in 1976,
70. Let's not go back that far. In the 90s.
I was born then. But you were viewed as a pioneer in telemedicine. And I find it funny only because, you know, when we talk about telemedicine today, a lot of people think, you know, people think it's kind of a new thing, right? But you are far, far ahead. What do you, you know, based on your experience, what you were doing back then and what you see today, I mean, how's it changed? And, you know, where do you think the future is for telemedicine?
Yeah, so just a quick history lesson. For the record, I didn't invent telemedicine. I'm not that old. It's actually about 50 years old when we first started going to the moon. And so those pictures of watching Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin and, you know, those early pioneers, they needed to be monitored. And so their health condition was monitored, and that information was sent back down here to flight surgeons, doctors here on Earth. And that was the beginning of telemedicine. They called it remote medicine. They didn't even have the term telemedicine. And so when I came into NASA, I started developing equipment, diagnostic hardware, that needed the ability to do in-flight diagnosis and send that information back down here to the Earth. And that's how I got involved in telemedicine. We actually called it telematics, and then eventually became telemedicine. If you look at what the space program has bought us is, you know, the telecommunications and this ability to move information and data. We pushed, computers. We did invent computers, but we pushed the utilization of those computers. And all that set the stage for what we now call telemedicine. Now, when I first started, probably in the late 80s and 90s, actually applying this, we did not have the bandwidth. We didn't have the technology. Mm-hmm. And even when I started Vesalius Ventures in 2002, we didn't have this. You know, I remember going down to UTMB, which has one of the first telemedicine businesses in the country. And they had T2 lines.
Oof.
You know, so they connected, you know, and you guys probably, these guys.
Yeah, they don't know about that.
But there were dedicated communication lines between, you know, one office to the other,
yeah.
Right? In this case, it was UTMB to the prison system because they were providing that. Now, we have broadband that's just readily available. We have technology in our pocket. Telemedicine has just expanded. And if I was to define telemedicine now, I would define it as an industry. I would define it as the intersection of IT, telecommunications, and medical devices. And all of that for the utilization of healthcare, you know, for, you know, providing healthcare. That would be the definition that I would use.
That's awesome. And I'm actually very excited about, you know, the whole industry of healthcare and telemedicine. And I think both of you play a very significant role in terms of, you know, where that's heading. And Sara, you, I remember you and I met just about 2 years ago, and we were both, you know, kind of just venturing into, you know, what are you going to do, you know, sort of next. Tell us a little bit about your sort of your aha moment, you know, in terms of leaving AMD and saying, okay, I need to go do something. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to be doing something. And I know it took you a while to kind of figure out, you know, what is it going to be? And then you settled on True Wealth Ventures. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. Yeah, it was a long road kind of to really put it all together. My career is very disparate, but finally all the puzzle pieces hung together. So I knew I wanted to be in venture, really just for, you know, the reasons that I mentioned previously. And being in Austin, my previous venture experience was in the Bay Area, and coming back to Austin, I was really excited about the opportunity for venture capital in Austin, given how much innovation happens here, yet how few funds are here. And the few funds that are here were and pretty much still are targeted on B2B enterprise software, SaaS, and some heavily FDA regulated kind of medical device implant type of technologies. Mm-hmm. But I was looking at my mechanical engineering focus was in green design and manufacturing. My minor was in public health, and then I started a brewery here, 512 Brewing Company, that uses, it's kind of as green and healthy as a brewery can be, in that it uses all organic grains, gives the spent grain to organic farmers, uses all reusable packaging. So I got integrated into a different part of the community where there's a lot of innovation happening here in Austin, with Whole Foods headquartered here in a very health conscious kind of community. So I realized there were some pretty big gaps in the venture capital funding and the capital that is accessible to entrepreneurs here that were innovated in these other spaces, and a lot of talent in that area. So I was getting resolution on that. But meanwhile, while I was still working at AMD very full time with two children and with a husband starting this, you know, microbrewery, I didn't have a lot of bandwidth to think about, you know, what next. But it did hit me at about 2 a.m. one morning that I had never met a woman in venture capital. And sorry, let me back up. I was asked to be, I was voluntold, I heard is the term now, at AMD to be the executive sponsor of the Global Women's Forum, which was a group of just all their women globally to network and do career development kinds of things. And I was asked to do that because I was the only vice president in Austin where all the leadership sat that had a technical or operational background, and they didn't want it to be an HR deal. That's what I was told. So I started doing my research to see what should I do with this group, and should I even do this, you know, volunteer position. And came across this McKinsey & Company study that showed, with their database of mainly Fortune 500 publicly traded companies, the top quartile of the companies in that database with the most women in senior leadership positions saw 41% higher return on equity and 56% higher operating performance. And so I had never ever in all of my McKinsey days or business days, you know, ever seen any type of metric that had such strong financial correlation. So started really getting interested in what a powerful business lever that was to get more women in senior leadership positions, and how seemingly easy that thing was compared to the other, you know, things we were trying to do, at least at AMD. But then starting to really appreciate how long it takes to get that pipeline, mm-hmm. you know, filled and change over the leadership teams and the board of directors even more. You know, it's so appreciating it was going to take a while and the magnitude of the problem that it was.
Right.
But then realized at 2 a.m. one morning, my kind of aha moment was, wow, I've literally never met a woman in venture capital, literally, in my Bay Area days, getting reacquainted with the Austin ecosystem, and then started looking into those numbers and saw, you know, it's about 1% of venture capitalists that are actually making investment decisions are women. And in terms of the venture capital, you know, backed companies, 2.7% is the number of women led. So they have similar financial outperformance in the VC-backed startup world as they do in the Fortune 500, and just realized this is the best business opportunity I've ever seen besides 512 Brewing Company up until now. Just had to do it.
Just had to do it.
Yep. It was not really, well, anyway, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and that's, you know, pretty important, right? When you hear that, just had to do it, and there's like, there was nothing else for her to do. She just went down that path to just do it, make it happen, which is outstanding. Bernard, you've had a VC firm for 15 years. I know when I started 2 years ago, getting involved in the tech startup scene in Austin and looking at the landscape very similarly to what Sara was doing in terms of the challenges in terms of diversity in the tech startup space, who was getting, you know, what companies were getting invested in, who the entrepreneurs, what the entrepreneurs look like. And I did that, you know, research. And then I also looked at the investor landscape. And I don't know, I spent days poring over trying to find investors that looked like me. And I was encouraged personally to become an angel investor because someone said to me, I've never met an African-American angel investor, which was mind-blowing to me. And they were based out of the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. And so when I met Bernard, I was just like in awe, right? It's like, well, yeah, he's a VC. And I stopped in my tracks and I was like, okay, if I'm not meeting anybody else today, I am meeting this guy. You know, didn't know he was gonna be an astronaut too, you know, indeed. So, but Bernard, I mean, again, sort of another, I'm not gonna say, you know, I'll be careful not to say the pioneer, but clearly 15 years as a VC, African-American male in medicine, that's pioneering by all, I mean, beyond my imagination. Tell me about your moment and, you know, what were the odds? I mean, you know, you made it, you was that, you know, tell me your story.
So I mentioned a few minutes ago that I got involved in venture capital because of working for Vanguard Ventures, and mm-hmm. I convinced them to be the lead investor for Vesalius. That's how I got started. In fact, that's how Sara and I met, because part of our investment partners, one of our investment partners was Fremont Ventures, which mm-hmm. she was working at the time. So we've known each other for quite some time. I'm much older than she is, by the way. You can probably tell that. I have to say this, in terms of women and minorities in venture capital, I think I have probably been 3 or 4 years after founding Vesalius Ventures before I saw another African-American manager. Mm. And then I was introduced to a group called the National Investment Companies, NAIC, mm-hmm. and NAIC was where emerging managers went to get together and talk about their common issues. So it was minorities and women investors. And the whole conference is about 400 people, maybe, and only about 150 or 200 were actually managers. The rest were, you know, service providers, mm-hmm. attorneys and accountants and people that were coming. And occasionally some, you know, investors, pension funds would, partners would come there to me. So it's a very small group, and I think the numbers in terms of the number of minority managers are probably very similar to women managers, maybe a tick higher, maybe. Yeah. I don't mm-hmm. know mm-hmm. of that. Mm-hmm. So it was challenging to try to find someone. And then I have to tell you, the first time that I saw a African-American CEO come into my office was probably about 5 years ago.
Wow.
And but the fortunate things in that 5 years, we probably had at least 10 or so So I see this movement happening.
And now some African American women too.
I beg your pardon?
And now some African American women too.
Exactly, African American women, right. Yeah. So it's really kind of nice to see that I believe the industry is evolving, but we are a fraction, you know, probably less than 2% if you combine the women and African American managers in the whole landscape of venture capital firms that are out there.
So let's delve just a little bit more into that, and you know, why do you think that is? I mean, obviously, you know, some of it may be, lack of funding, or is it just lack of know-how, lack of exposure, or what do you think, you know?
I've got a strong opinion on it.
I do too. Yeah. I want to hear her opinion first.
I just think it's not this type of corporate environment where you get an HR team to get you a slate of candidates to look through all the resumes or something. It's a complete good old, it's like the stereotypical good old boys network where, you start a venture capital fund with your buddies out of Harvard Business School that went to Goldman Sachs for a while, and now there's, or whatever, and they've got a pool of money from all their dads, and they get, and I mean, it's not a joke.
And it's not a joke.
And so that's kind of how they all started. And then the way to break in is either to go to, get your MBA, go to management consulting or investment bank, get some analyst associate position at a VC firm, and then either go to a corporate role and get a successful career there and then get pulled back from one of your buddies, or start your own company, make a ton of money, and then pool your money together with your other buddies and start your own firm. Or you get lucky enough that you get selected to go run a family office's pool of money, and that's, again, because your buddy's dad needs somebody. And so it's the same group of people who have been invested in the same group of entrepreneurs for the most part. It's very much of a network, and so it's very hard to break in because it's so relationship based.
Yeah. So I remember I had a meeting with a good friend of mine, and his name, I will not use his name because he's very famous, especially in the state of Texas. And we were at River Oaks Country Club. And we sat down, and I wanted a one-on-one meeting with him. And I said, how do you break into venture capital? And he says, you don't break in. You get invited in. Mm. And so to me, when you look at, sort of the financial structure of how things operate, the venture capital is probably at the tip of the iceberg. You've got investment bankers, you've got banks and investment banking, and you've got PE firms, you've got buyout firms, but you get to the venture capital because it is a high-risk type of scenario here. It's a small group of people at the top, and that small group of people at the top is going to remain small because it relies on the network that Sara just mentioned. So you have to be invited in. Then you have to prove yourself. So if you look at, we've already talked about the numbers, the demographics. If that group of folks at the top are all white guys, what are the chances of a woman piercing that ceiling, or an African-American person, or a minority? We keep talking about, but minorities in general. The Hispanic community has the same issues that we have. So it's a big issue. And also remember that when people have money, they like to keep that money within their circles.
Yeah.
So it's hard to break in those circles. And the same thing would be true for corporate boards. So if you look at corporate boards, which is a network, you'll find at the top of the boards, and like the Fortune 50, you'll see a lot of crossover between board members. Mm-hmm. And again, it's that whole mentality. And then one thing I'll say, we're humans, right? Mm-hmm. And so we're going to be comfortable with people who think like we do, who are educated like we are, who come from the same circles. And so it's hard to break into that circle. And one thing I will say, looking at this audience here, I think it behooves people like Sarah, myself, and folks of color that when you get there, and you will get there, we don't want to be discouraging, saying that you're not going to get there. You will get there. Mm-hmm. But when you get there, then you have to form that same sort of network and bring others along who look like you.
Yeah, that's great. And I think that creates a lot of excitement. It should create a lot of excitement for our audience to see the opportunity that exists. By seeing the two of you as successful venture capitalists, as successful human beings, if you will, it represents the opportunity and the possibility of what is there. And thank you for sharing that. So I'm going to shift gears a little bit. So when you guys were younger, if you will, you were pursuing mechanical engineering, right? And you were pursuing, trying to be an astronaut from the age of 13. And I know probably if I had one of my buddies come to me and say, hey, I'm going to be an astronaut when I grow up, I'm like, okay, yeah, man, you go right ahead and do that. You can go down to Walmart, go get yourself a space helmet, and you'll be good. Tell me, the positive, the positive support that you did get, and also, what were some of the negative pullback, because mechanical engineering, a woman going in there, and not only that, correct me if I'm wrong, this is a 4.0 sister over here, right? Not just in her undergrad, but also in the master's program, 4.0, and then also in PhD.
Okay? I studied way too much.
Yeah, give it up for her. I mean, that's no joke. So, I guess if I'm in the same class with her and she's crushing it like that, we have to be best friends. We have to be best friends. So, if you can, give us both the positive support that really helped you thrust through a lot of the, perceptions of what you're supposed to, what you can be, and, some of the, negative that was pulling back at you.
You want to go first?
Yeah, you do it.
Okay. I can think of a lot more positives than negatives. I mean, I had a very, very stable, great foundation with my family who, I was in good school systems and was encouraged to do my homework and, do well. And so that really is extremely helpful. And never had to worry about money or food or like any of the basics. And then my dad was a mechanical engineer and then had gone on to get his MBA and gone into management consulting. So that's exactly what I did for the most part.
Daddy's little girl.
Yeah, and I just saw a career, like that looks fun. And so so I had a career path, at least a trajectory, like a launching pad sort of laid out for me that I got to see firsthand. Otherwise, there's no way I would have done that, I don't think. And there were definitely, so people would be surprised, like, oh my goodness, look how you solved that problem. That's not the way that we taught it, but that works, and wow, And so they were surprised. They're like, oh, honey, look at that drafting work. That's really good,
Okay. For a girl.
For a girl, so exactly. So it exactly. And so, maybe that helped, but I also got the flip side, which was, getting your teeth cleaned in high school, and the dentist is like, what do you want to do when you go to college? I'm going to go to engineering. Really? You have to be good at math for that. it's little things like that. There's just little chips away.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But for the most part, I was blind to all that, and I was blind to all of it until I read that McKinsey study, which got me going about, oh my gosh, I am the only woman that's a vice president that has any kind of technical or operational background. And I had never even realized I was the only woman because I was always a mechanical engineer, I was in the semiconductor group, the semiconductor industry and venture capital, started a brewery, it's all male. And so I didn't even realize. And then when I started seeing the unconscious bias that exists and how at meetings it's very normal for a woman to say something Nobody notices. The man says something like, oh, great point, Jim. And then I started seeing it happen. I was like, oh, no. This is terrible. And I feel like if I hadn't been blind to it, it would have been a real problem.
It would have been a real problem.
Yeah. So I just never took it personally, never really noticed it, and just felt a lot of encouragement in general. I didn't notice the other stuff.
That's awesome.
Thankfully.
But, how about as you were talking, I was thinking about the invisible power that I think this country misses by that unconscious bias that's pervasive in everything that we do in this country. And I would say around the world, because I've had a chance to travel around the world, on Earth, around the world, which is important.
Both. Yeah.
So, but let me make this point. So when I was a kid thinking about being an astronaut, you know, this was in the late 60s. We just got as African-American, right to vote. And for an African-American kid to think about becoming an astronaut, you know, I didn't tell a lot of people because of, are you sure? Because when you looked at television, you didn't see anybody who looked like, you know, me. I didn't see any women. I didn't see any minorities. And so I actually kept it a secret for a long time until probably got into high school. Wow. And just as you said, you know, shared with my buddies, you know, sitting in the street, you know, playing and say, you know, what do you want to do? I want to be a dentist, or I want to be a doctor, I want to be an astronaut. I was like, what? An astronaut? So, but anyway, at some point in time in your life, you have to decide if you have a dream that you're going to do it despite or because of. Right. Mm-hmm. And for me, not seeing someone that looked like me in the astronaut program was sort of a call to action. It was like, okay, well, I'll be the first in that. I wasn't the first African-American. That was a guy at Bluford who came a few years before I did, but I was the first African-American to walk in space. And think about that feat. Until I did that spacewalk, it had been 30 years before from the first walk by Ed White, 30 years before a person of color got a chance to go outside. And within the astronaut office, and when you look at the hierarchy, you know, we become astronauts, either a pilot or mission specialist, and then you become payload commander, which I did. But everybody wants to don that 350-pound spacesuit and walk outside. Very few women and minorities have had a chance to do that, and I was the first to break that ceiling. And there's been, you know, a lot of folks since that time. So that says to me that this unbiased discrimination, there's no other way to put it, is pretty pervasive, and we have to actively try to figure out how we can, you know, work on that and get that resolved. And I'll go back to what I said when I opened up my statement. We're losing a lot of talent and experience and power that's in this group of individuals who are ignored. Yeah. And if we are going to be as powerful of a country as I think that we are, we've got to tap into that.
Yeah.
And here's my commercial. You did your brewery. I'm going to do my commercial on the foundation. So I formed the Harris Foundation to focus on education, health, and wealth to help economically disadvantaged communities to be able to grow and to become and become part of the society, valuable part of society. We call them our pillars for success, education, health, and wealth, because I believe that in order for an individual or a community to advance, they have to be educated.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They have to be healthy individuals, healthy communities, and they have to be able to manage money to build wealth. That's the only way we're going to ever end up with parity in this country, in our communities.
Great stories from both of you, and I think they're very, very significant in sharing, you know, the overcoming of challenges and just having, you know, your focus and persistence on the vision ahead of you. And as we look forward, and talk about, you know, Bernard, you already sort of alluded to sort of like the giving back portion that the foundation does. In both of your lives, I mean, obviously the day-to-day, you're trying to make an impact, you know, with women in entrepreneurship, and then, you know, in the healthcare space with telemedicine and also with the Harris Foundation. What else? I mean, for this audience here, you know, how else can, or what would you recommend each of us sort of start to, how we give back to really tap into that power? I think that's really important, and especially as you're sort of making your way, even though you are young, but there's a way to move forward and actually still pull from behind at the same time. So, you know, Sara, what do you, you know, from your perspective, what are you doing today to continue that journey, you know, outside of just true wealth? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I think it took a lot of internal work to figure out what it was exactly that True Wealth Ventures was going to be. And I feel like I made it my full-time job to make my impact and give back. And I think I learned that from, you know, back when I was the executive sponsor of the Global Women's Forum, and realizing that the C-suite wasn't going to care about this until it was integrated into the strategy of the company. And it was directly related to the business outcomes. And so, and there's a great case for it, because women make 85% of consumer purchase decisions. And so at AMD, it's you know, it's a kind of an Intel inside strategy. Can't believe I said Intel inside for AMD. But anyway, people know that, what that strategy is. And so it's women who are making a lot of the game console purchases and the laptop purchases, and the, you know, but it doesn't seem like that when you're just looking at the, you know, techie semiconductor space. And so there's a great business case to be made for why you need to engage more women on an executive leadership team. So I feel like my give back is in many ways, but it's really trying to show people the power of the increased innovation and better products and technologies and, you know, impacts that can be made with more women at the leadership table, who understand in many cases what the customer needs better, because they are the customer more. Mm-hmm. Or making 80% of healthcare decisions. It's women who are taking usually care of their health, I'd say better than the counterpart, from my experience. But making their family's health decisions, making their spouse's decisions, making their elder parents' decisions a lot of times. So anyway, there's a lot of business case to be made around it. And of course, helping women entrepreneurs, you know, find their way, get them money, which is what I identified as the biggest issue, the biggest hurdle. And so that's why I'm really focusing on the capital piece.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think the empowerment piece is really critical. I mean, Bernard, you're doing a lot through your foundation. Can you expound more on, you know, all that you're doing, not just here, but also, you know, in Africa, in your camps, and all the various programs that you do?
But let me start with this, because I think it's important. And this thread goes through all our programs in the foundation, that you must, as an individual, discover your own internal power. If you can empower yourself and realize your full potential, then and then be not be afraid to act on that. Right? And the problem that I see in this country sometimes is, there's external pressure to hold you back. And so you have to figure out what is your internal strategy. And once you accomplish that, and this goes across the board, whether you're, you know, man or woman, black or white, mm-hmm. or, you know, whatever, if once you discover that, then nobody can hold you back. And you can do wonderful things. In fact, one of the things that I like to do when I'm talking to student audiences, I remind them who they are. And we tell them that they're infinite beings with infinite possibilities. And then I try to describe to them what that means. It means that you were born multipotential, with the ability to do anything that you want to do in life. That decision is yours. That you're born multi-talented. We're all born with certain talents, and then we can use our brain to learn other talents. That's why you're in school, right? Because you're learning other talents. Again, that's your choice. But more importantly, the most empowering thing that message I can deliver to individuals, not only the individuals that I talk to, but individuals in this room, that you were born for a reason. And if you truly believe that, that there is something special that you are to do, and you go after that special thing, guess what? You're going to be successful. And you'll be able to take care of yourself and take care of your family. So that's what we try to, you know, integrate into all of our programs. So I mentioned earlier, education, health, and wealth is what we focus on. We run the largest summer science camp for economically disadvantaged kids in the country. We're in 20 universities nationally. We do a dream tour where we go off and go out and try to encourage kids to look at math and science. All of this is kind of STEM and STEAM-based education programs. We have crime prevention programs because we know that in the minority communities that crime can be an issue. And so we teach kids how to make right choices. Mm-hmm. On the health side, we encourage people to come up with novel ideas to help their communities, called Community Health Leaders Program. And then on the wealth side, we actually have a digital program that's now being deployed nationally to do financial literacy. And part of that financial literacy goes from how to balance your checkbook to, you know, how do you look at your credit report, to how do you select insurance, to how do you become an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. so all of those, and you can go to the harrisfoundation.org and you can see our programs.
Awesome. And I want to, you know, just share, I just happened to read over a quote last night. You know, it was from Muhammad Ali, and he once said, if my head can actually conceive it and your heart can believe it, then I can achieve it, right? So along with, you know, Bernard was saying, you find that special place, right, and, you know, your special purpose, and you have to really fight off the external forces to really kind of pursue your own. And some, you know, for some people, they get it pretty early in life, and some, it takes a while, right? But you got to keep, you know, fighting against external forces and then tap into that inner power, if you will, to go drive to what you're supposed to achieve in life. So that's great. I want to go ahead and just open it up, if I could, to some questions, because I know I see that burning sensation out there, you know, to ask some questions. So let me just go ahead and open it up, and for some questions for you, if you don't mind coming down to the microphone, and we'll take a few questions. Okay, yeah, okay.
Hi, I'm Rob Lajanas, I'm a first-year MBA student. I wanted to ask about just like venture capitalists and what you look for in teams. So as someone looking to start my own venture, one of the things is like, do you have experience? And what do you guys look for, like if it's a student-run team, to have confidence in that?
So we're investing in early stage. And so at that point, there's usually not even a product. You know, it might be a minimally viable product, it might be project, who knows. So a lot has to do with team. A lot has to do with the vision and the market size and knowing that things are going to change a lot. And so as long as the market's big enough and the need is big enough for the team to continue to pivot and finally find the right solution. But, you know, there are a lot of student teams that have been very successful. And so for us, it's really looking at sort of the work ethic, the dynamic, how long the groups work together. But it is very important.
And I have slightly different twists, and it's probably because of how I got into venture capital. I personally think that it's good for you to go and get experience in working for a company. Whether it's AMD or Intel or no. ExxonMobil or whatever, because in the field that you're focused in, so whatever the major is, because that will allow you to figure out how corporations, large corporations, think, right? It also will give you some skills that you just don't get in MBA school. We all did the MBA thing, and So that experience is, I think, is really necessary before you can go out successfully. I mean, it's not, you know, I'm making this comment, but there are certainly exceptions. But I would say that most of the companies that we've seen that have been successful, it's because the teams have experience, and either they have started a company and failed and learned from that, or they were part of a larger company. And then the other piece that I will add is that whatever you're doing, eventually you want to have an exit, right? You either want to do an IPO, and the IPO market is not that good right now. And so the M&A market is much better. So that means someone's going to buy your company. So you need to know how they think. So get the experience is what I would suggest.
Thank you.
Hi, can you hear me? Sorry, good. My name's Andrew, I work at a startup here in Austin. I really liked your guys' answer about the kind of the triangle structure that you see in the corporate world, the on boards and stuff. But it's still not clear to me how you started your VCs. There's a good old boys club, but did you assimilate to that club? Or did you surround yourself with people like you and start your venture capitalist firm? For someone who wants to try and break into that area, do you sidestep it or do you assimilate, right? Mm-hmm. That's my question.
Well, I think both of us got experience with other firms first, mm-hmm. Okay. Right? Before we stepped out, which was really good. And by doing that, you end up, getting into their network and then developing your network from there. And that's how I did it.
Mm-hmm. Similar. I had previous experience, but it really was jumping off and fundraising with a whole different type of community, because for a small venture capital fund, you're not fundraising from institutional investors, you're fundraising more from family offices and individuals, which is a whole different deal. Before at Fremont, we had the Bechtel family office just give us $150 million. So that's like one lunch, whereas it's much different for me. It's a lot of lunches. So.
That's so true. Yeah. That helps.
Sure does.
You can find a family office that believes in you.
Yeah.
And you can convince them to give you $100 million. Hey.
So you probably have to do more my way.
I'm going to throw a question in there. As an investor over, multiple experience, have you had any misses? Like any big misses, whether it's like, okay, well, I lost a lot of money on that one, or doggone, I missed that boat. Uh-huh. Can you recall any, and what were your lessons learned from that?
I'll share my first investment. After I first investment after forming Vesalius Ventures. The way we are structured, we have venture capital firms that are part of our investment. We call them investment partners. Fremont Ventures was one of our partners. Vanguard Ventures, Seven Rosen. These are really big mm-hmm. firms in Boston mm-hmm. Scientific. So I brought to the group this company that San Diego based that I thought was, it was great. It had a device that could be implanted under the skin, and it was a closed loop system. It was cutting edge technology, convinced all the investors to invest $5 million in the deal. And I was really proud of myself because this was my first deal, and I got everybody to put money up to invest in this deal. And then that evening, I get a call from one of my investors that said, "Hey, Bernard, that CEO that we agreed to invest in? He just called me." And I said, why did he call you? Because he was trying to hook his own little side deal. So he was calling other investors to say, "Well, I know you're going to get $5 million, but if you give me 10, I'll give you more of my company." Basically,
wow.
He did an in-around, wow. on the syndicate that I had put together. And so that was a big failure for me, just starting the firm. Now, of course, before he hung up, he says, "Well, we're out of this deal because..." And why do you think they're out of that deal? Anybody want to guess?
Because you were so willing to put the other deal away quickly that the new deal didn't trust you enough, in a sense.
So it has to do with trust, mm-hmm. right? We invest in people. We don't necessarily invest in only the technology. So you can take an A technology or a C technology, and if you have an A team, you'll do much. We'll invest in that, right? Versus a technology and a C team, you know. So we invest in people. So the what I learned is that if you can't trust the person you're giving the money to, you should not be giving the money. And so that's why they backed out of that deal. And so you know, you just have to be careful. Unfortunately, that CEO, when he did that, he could not raise money for his company because word got around pretty quickly that you couldn't trust this guy. So integrity, guys, is probably the your best asset in whatever you do in life.
Sara, any?
Well, it's too early to say, but I sure don't think so at this point.
which is great. And Bernard, I really appreciate your story there, because I'm trying to imagine first deal, right? Here you are, you put all these great people, they believe in you, and you've got this deal going, and this is not chump change, right? And now people are like, whoa. And I mean, were you worried? Like, okay, I just started this thing, it's going to go down the drain. It could go down the drain pretty quick.
Yeah. So he not only affected himself, but affected me too,
right?
Because by default, it's like, okay, you didn't figure out that this deal was, you know, this guy, you know, the type of personality he was. And so I learned a lot.
Yeah.
Pay a lot more attention to the team and their background before I invest in companies. Yep.
Question, Michael?
Hi, so for the group of us that are trying to go into entrepreneurship straight out of school, we are forming teams and bringing ideas to investors, but our teams aren't the A teams like some of the prior serial entrepreneurs that are out there. What kind of piece of advice, or what one piece of advice would you give students that are trying to go into entrepreneurship right away out of school on raising capital or just navigating the entrepreneurial scene?
Well, one thing I look at with student teams is what's the commitment to actually stay with the idea? Because a lot of, you know, these teams are formed during the, you know, MBA or the whatever it is. And so is everybody still interviewing for jobs that are going to go, you know, join Microsoft or something after this is over? Or is the team completely committed to staying on? So I actually get into some personal things of like, what's the real commitment before I even look at the company seriously? So that, because that's such a concern up front. So I think really making sure your team is committed beyond is kind of, you know, checkbox number one. And then, I mean, the recipe I've seen work really well is getting a nice diverse team. It's not natural. It's not happening in most of the founding teams out there. And so if you can get really good diversity that's representative of the customer space, then you do have a real advantage that you students, generally speaking, have more bandwidth. They have more stamina to stay up until 2 a.m. every day or whatever it is. And you can really innovate where other people aren't and really do amazing work.
And I would add that find some advisors and mentors that can help you, that know the technology, know the space, know the market. Preferably a serial entrepreneur, someone who's done it before, so they can tell you what you don't know. Because you don't know what you don't know. You probably heard that already, right? You really don't, until you don't know it.
Until you know it. And then you're like, oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, go like, I know that.
Yeah. And there's a lot of great support here. I mean, in Austin and at UT to get that kind of mentorship.
Thank you.
Next question.
Hello, my name is Ikenna Okoro. I'm a first-year law student here at UT. And I was wondering, Dr. Brand, how you settled on starting 512 Brewery, and also if for students with multiple ideas that we might want to start, how would you all go about weighing which venture we should pursue?
Well, I've got a very quantitative background in mind. So it was came down to a numbers game for me, really. And my husband was a crazy, we had met at UT as undergrads in mechanical engineering in thermodynamics class, actually. And so, it's a true story.
Over the Bunsen burner? No.
No, it was more like he figured out I was doing really well on the quizzes.
That was it.
Yeah.
That's great.
So anyway, he was an avid microbrewer, and home brewer. He'd started with our senior design project here at UT, and the third person on our senior design project was doing a lot of microbrewing, home brewing. It was a crazy passion and hobby of his to the point where in our refrigerator, I was traveling all over the world all the time. And so I came home one day and the shelving was removed from our refrigerator and there were just two kegs in it. So I got the door for my condiments and then the little produce like around the kegs. And so I was really thrilled to get it out of the house, frankly. He wanted to do it during retirement. And that's what we always kind of talked about, but just more like over a beer, like dreaming about, oh yeah, one day we'll start a microbrewery. But then we moved back to Austin from the Bay Area, all the good beer was gone. I won't say who was still here, but there was very few, there was like 1.5 kind of breweries here and no IPA, which was my favorite style. And so we started just looking at the business opportunity and doing like a McKinsey analysis, you know, here's the market size and here's the barriers to entry and everything. I'm like, whoa, this is amazing. Texas is huge and they drink a lot, you know? So there was just nobody doing organic or, you know, big, bold kind of beers. And so the first day I went back to, speaking of like scary moments, first day I went back to from maternity leave is when I explained to the full-time nanny I had just hired that there's going to be this guy in the living room who's going to be starting a business, so don't worry about him. It was just a kind of a crazy time and risk, but also it really panned out on the business plan.
And I would just say, pick the thing that you're most passionate about.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
We have time for, I think, one more question.
Perfect. Hello, my name's Miriam, and I was wondering, say you're in a group of a few people, and you're the only person, or you're part of the minority group that thinks it's a bad idea to do something. At what point do you step up and cause a little bit of tension and make people discuss it in a bit more detail? Should you be that one that brings up the idea and is like, I don't think it's a good idea and it's going to go downhill, or, you know, something like that?
Yes. be that one. Because sometimes when you have teams, you can get into this the same think, you know, mind think. Everybody thinks the same thing. We're going to be great. And they don't see the obstacles and you may see it. So you should bring it up. You do the team and the company injustice if you don't, if you sit on that. And, you know, through that discussion, you may find out that they're right, right? But if you don't bring it up, it's always going to nag at you, right? And if it fails because you didn't bring it up, then you're going to feel bad about that.
Gotcha. Thank you.
I would also just say if you feel like you're not, your ideas or your, aren't being well received, there's some really good strategies of how you can come with a counter idea, but to say like, yes, and, so keep it positive, and the way you frame it with the team can really be effective.
Yeah. Okay. Before we head out, any last words of inspiration, you know, dreaming big, pursue your dreams, or what have you, that you guys would love to share with us before we say goodnight? Bernard?
Dream big. Follow your passion. Don't be that 60-year-old that looks back and says, I should have done that.
Yeah.
Don't do that. So even though it may be risky and you may be stepping out, take that risk, because it's the people who take that risk are the ones who ultimately are successful.
Mm-hmm. And drive innovation and create wealth and actually make a real impact. Yeah, I'd say the same thing. And really just take the time to quiet your mind and really figure out, even though it might take 20 years, like what is yours to uniquely do? Because there's something.
All right. Thank you guys so much. Tremendous honor. Absolutely a tremendous honor for me. And thank you both for coming. And on behalf of the Herb Kelleher Center, we thank you, UT, thank you. And thank the audience for your engagement. And good night. Thank you.
Good night.